calm, the energy going, make them feel happy, make them feel welcome to the stage. Please welcome Susie Porter and Jacquie Brennan.
What great energy we have in the audience, and great fervour for you guys. You look emotional.
It was actually quite emotional watching that. I just realised, like, it did actually. I could have cried. I just felt really grateful to be part of that show.
Me
when
too.
You see it all together, you just go, this was the best show as actors and as women to be part of.
And men. Sorry,
and men.
No, it's like, That's why I made that initial point when I came out here, because when we were talking yesterday and stuff, and all through our experience, the word gratitude, I think, is such a big one for us, because we all used to sit around in the green room going, can you believe it? Can you believe we're actually working on this show? This is so bloody cool. And it's kind of like almost like pinching ourselves going, I can't believe that we're on this show, because it's so great. And it has, you know, obviously so groundbreaking for women as well, right?
Yeah. And then just from everything, from the scripts to the directors we worked with, to the actors we worked with, it was such a privilege. And getting to meet all of you guys all around the world.
Yes. Speaking of all around the world, there's people come from a long way away. There's some people come from 8,000 miles away. Yes, that's right, over there. Some people from 10,000 miles away.
11,000.
Right? 11,000. I mean, who's counting, right? But this is commitment, right? People have come from all around the world to be here today to see you guys. So
thank you.
Yeah, that's gratitude, right?
Yeah, and it's amazing what you had said right at the beginning. It's true that we definitely wouldn't have got the last 20 without. It was because of also the fans, you guys writing in, all the producers and people at Foxtel saw all the online stuff and thought, shit, maybe we should do more. So we got another 20. So we really...
Because that's right, we had been cancelled.
We'd been cancelled. So
remember that, you know, the conversation that it was all over and how sad we were, and then suddenly everything changed. They started selling off everything. Do you remember that?
Yeah, that's right.
And so they started saying, oh, we're going to be selling the set, we're going to be selling costumes, and then suddenly they stopped selling everything, and we were like, oh my God,
yeah,
maybe we're back.
Yeah.
And we were, because of you. Well, not necessarily you, but maybe you.
Now, Jax, I want to just sort of say something.
Honest, when I came in season six, I was shitting myself. You know, that's the truth. I was kind of like, I remember my first day, they put a little radio mic sort of down in your bra, and my heart was going so fast and so loud. I thought, they're going to hear it on the boom, because she's like, dum, 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 and I had the driest mouth. But after the first scene I did with Tammy, and I've known Tammy for years, and then I relaxed into it. But to me, it was just such an honor. You know, I had watched the show, and I really wanted to be part of it from day one. And actually, I'd auditioned for the role of Bee many years ago. But then it's like, no one else could do Dan. Like, you know, you see Dan, and you're just like, well, it's perfect casting. You know, I can't imagine anyone else being Dad, but then somehow or other I was, you know, and so when I didn't get that, and I just...
I think Tammy also has a story where she also auditioned for Beastman.
Yeah. I auditioned for Liz.
You auditioned for Liz. That's what you've got to understand about this, the Australian industry, right? It is pretty small compared to something like America. So it's not unusual that actors of a similar age and a similar kind of experience would be all auditioning for the same role.
And every actor in the country wanted to be involved with this.
Every female actress. Like, I really thought I'd miss the boat with this. I thought, oh, it's never going to happen. I just had to accept that I wasn't going to be part of Wentworth, because I loved Prisoner, like, so much. And I grew up on that, and I just loved it. And but then, yeah, got a chance to audition, and then came in as Mari, and I just... Yeah, and she was a very complex character to play. It was kind of quite difficult, you know, but I absolutely loved it. But all the girls welcomed me, and all the girls kind of, like, told me about stuff and...
Showed you where the toilets were.
Showed me the toilet, where the dummies were, and everyone really embraced all the newcomers. So yeah, there is no, everyone was just really happy to be there.
We talked about this a lot yesterday, and the word that came up most was family. So, and that is obviously one of the strongest themes in Wentworth is family. You know, what do you, how do you create a family in a sort of an enclosed environment, which is what the women in Wentworth did. They had to create a family, and there were different families and different factions within that, but we also embodied that outside of the off the set, if you will, in the studio sort of thing, and you know, in terms of the actors and not just the actors staying as a family amongst themselves. It's all of the crew, all of the production office was all on campus, all in the same studio, and people like, you know, the editors were there, and the writers' room was there also, the art department. It's quite unusual to have all of those departments on campus. So we were one big family, weren't we?
But people would presume that because it was a lot of, in particular, women working together, that we'd all be at each other's throats. There was not none of that. We all really dug each other. We don't now. Just kidding. No, we just all really liked each other. Everyone was really supportive. And if someone had a really emotional scene, everyone would check in on them and see if they're okay. And, you know, that's a pretty rare beast to experience, isn't it?
Yeah. No, it was a magic. I still think, I mean, I would definitely say it's the best job I've ever been involved with.
I'd say the same thing, too.
Without a shadow of a doubt.
And it was, we were saying, yeah, thank you.
And you just kind of feel like it won't be, like, how can you ever, you can't replace Wentworth, but you often think as an actor, will I ever be able to have the depth of character like that and get to do it and be part of an ensemble? And also just such a great, like, that people loved the show. That's what we loved about it too. Yeah, like, yeah. You guys got so much out of it, you know.
But I think one of the other unusual things about this show was that the people who worked on the show were also fans of the show too.
Yeah.
You know, we'd all sit around in the green room and put the DVDs on and watch episodes and stuff like that. And
when those scripts came in, when the scripts would, you just hang for the scripts to come in every 2 weeks.
Yeah, because, oh, the scripts are in. And then your pigeonhole would come in, and everyone would go, oh, cool.
And you would not, you would just not stop. You'd just read. And not just because you were looking for, you know, what's Linda Miles doing this week.
Or did you die?
Or did I die?
And you get to the end of the episode and you go, oh, thank fuck, I'm still alive.
It was just like, the most, you know, exciting novel to read every 2 weeks.
And you'd be sitting in the green room and you'd be kind of, you know, someone would be, and they'd look over and they'd go, ooh. They point you and they go, what do I do? And they go, oh, you have to read it to find out. No spoilers. Just spoiler alert.
Yeah.
So you can share with the audience, because I'm sure they want to hear some of that. Like, there's some things that you created for Mari that perhaps never even got, you know, they're only in your head in terms of, oh, Mari did this, or Mari, were there any other little bits and pieces apart from that?
Well, that was probably the main thing of, like, if I look at a character and think what their core wound is as a kid and what drives them to be a certain way, and the fact that I was also like needed to have substances to deal with stuff. Well, if you've had an upbringing of, you know, sexual abuse and prostitution, of course you're going to need something to medicate yourself. So I kind of tried to make it as extreme. It just helped me, whether the audience ever picks that up, I don't know, but it helped me to be in that character and realise why she does the things she does and not judge the character for the...
You always have to have a backstory, don't you? I think it's really important.
Yeah.
And sometimes it's the back... None of the backstory will ever actually see, you know, the light of day in terms of television. It's only for you as an actor to create something that you feel like has dimensions and depth.
Yeah, I kind of do. I kind of have the analogy. It's like a stick figure on a piece of paper, and then this is the colouring in. So I kind of like really colour in all my legs and my arms, and to kind of create story and know what kind of my relationship with my son and my, you know, my whole entire backstory of when I first had drugs and why I needed drugs, and yeah. So I suppose you do all that work before you jump on set. But what was great with Wentworth is that everyone had a backstory. And not only the prisoners, but the guards and the people that worked in the prison were just as corrupt. Mm. You know, in lots of ways, they committed just as many crimes. That's what I loved about it. It's that, and every human being is flawed. And that's what I loved about it, because we're all bits of good and bad, and, you know, we all act in certain ways because of our experiences. So that's what I loved about it, is that all the characters were really three-dimensional.
Linda didn't have a backstory at all. Like, I had nothing to go on. So I sort of had to build her as I went. But I wrote a backstory for her as well. And also, they changed things on me all the time. I decided she had all these strong moral codes. Well, they weren't that strong. But, you know, that she would that she wouldn't deal in drugs. She would deal in money, but she wouldn't deal in drugs. She could tolerate violence, but never anything sexual against the women. But unfortunately, that got thrown out when she was with Boomer, trying to find the camera. Yeah. And she went into Boomer's cell with a large guard.
Yeah.
Yeah, I forgot that. But yeah, so I decided Linda was a teacher, and she'd been in a relationship. The gambling started getting worse. The relationship broke up. She lost the house. She started working at the prison because she heard the money was good. So she had nothing. There was nothing in her life. So and she didn't give a fuck about any of them. She just wanted to get out of there and get to the races or the pokies. So that was her whole modus operandi, was just, you know, making money from gambling or losing money from gambling.
That final season, I remember us having a conversation and you were saying, geez, Linda's kind of, she's turned real nasty, like, and there's a bit of trauma. There's a bit of trauma that's coming out in this kind of, where she's whacking people and she's...
Well, that was because of Mari. Yeah. Don't blame me. That was because of the siege. That's it. Yeah, the siege.
That's right. The siege changed you. That's right.
Yeah, Linda got PTSD.
PTSD, that's right.
But I did struggle with that. That was really hard when you love a character so much and they become so violent. And I got a little muscle from the aspartame.
That's really hard. You really went for that too. You know, yeah. Talk about immersion in the character.
Yeah, that was PTSD. So she was actually, the whole violence part of Linda was actually trying to keep herself safe. That was her, you know, by keeping everyone who she felt was dangerous away, she could feel safe.
I think that was also another one of those kind of really strong themes throughout the course of the whole series of Wentworth. I mean, obviously there's family, there's power. What do you do to get power? What do you do when you get the power? What do you do with it? And then there's also what you were just saying, which is, I kind of just lost my train of thought. What were you just saying about, there was another theme that I was thinking that was really strong in Wentworth. Anyway, we can move on. Because you were, what were you just saying?
No, I have these really... Now.
I must be getting old. I'm having a real sort of...
It's a PTSD thing, like...
Anyway, don't worry about it.
Gambling?
I was going to... No, I'll come back to it. I'll come back to it when I remember. I'm having a senile moment. But in terms of the stuff that we used to have to do on set, right, and we had to do some pretty heavy lifting and heavy stuff that went on. I mean, Mari obviously got, you know, there was a lot of kind of heavy stuff. And we often get asked, the question, one of the most common questions we get asked is like, what was the antidote for that? How did you kind of, you know, come out of those moments? And we always say it was because we just kind of goofed off, you know what I mean? We always tried to keep the mood light and a sense of levity and playing practical jokes on each other and just having a laugh, right? And I just remember, you know, both of you, we always had a real laugh on set, didn't we? And just kind of having...
Yeah, I think you got to have fun with this stuff as well. Like, obviously, when they kind of go turnover, you know, action, you've got to be there 100%. But leading up to it and after it, like, you'd be killing someone and then, like, you're really into it and then they'd say cut and then you'd be able to crack up a laugh with each other, you know, and I think that is an kind of an important thing to do also, because sometimes it's really funny as well.
Yeah.
You know, some of the
violence, you loved fighting.
I loved it. I really, really loved it. And look, sometimes I wasn't that good at it, but I really loved it. I really loved doing the stunts. I really loved doing all of that stuff you know, because there is a violence in my life, in my real life. So to be able to play that and to play a character who's so violent, doesn't really care what people think about, was it actually quite a liberating thing.
Yeah.
But you did, remember 8A where everyone hated her? Was that 8A? You did suffer with that. You found that really hard because you're such a warm person. I just remember you saying how hard that was, you know, just feeling that everyone hated you everywhere you walked. And
yeah, it was. And I remember, like, you know, coming home and even walking in the street, like, all my shoulders were down. I'd look at the floor and I was kind of like, what's... And I actually got quite depressed in that when she was in isolation for 3 months and then tries to kill herself and... Oh, just the whole thing. I found the last two seasons really, really quite difficult, you know, for that reason. Before then, it was just like Siege was so much fun. And, you know, I'd fantasized about pressing that steam press since I was a little kid. So, you know, the season before, and Tammy's like, you got to work out how you're going to do it. You're going to do it one finger, you're going to do it that. And I'm like, look, at this present point in time, I have to step up onto a box because I'm so short. Yeah, to do the steam press. So I was thinking, I used to laugh, thinking, oh my God, so much for this top dog. Like, I was like, little, I just like step up on a box. But that kind of stuff was fun. But the last two seasons I found really quite difficult. I mean, challenging as an actor, but also as a person. And it was also COVID as well. So it was
We lost our sense of family.
It was such a weird time.
I got pulled over because we were shooting, I don't know how many people are actually from Melbourne here, shooting during COVID. We were considered an essential service because we were already filming. And I live along the bay and we had the curfews. Remember the curfews? Weren't they fun?
8 p.m. I think, wasn't it? 8 o'clock or something.
Yeah.
In your house.
And we'd shot a really bloody scene, and I had blood all over me. Luckily, I went to makeup, and they got it off. But yeah, I got pulled over 10 minutes from my house, and had to show my papers, which was so dystopian, and you know, to say why I was out and about. So yeah, and COVID, unfortunately, we couldn't sit with the crew anymore and have lunch. You know, all those things that sort of make you a family when you're shooting something. All of that was lost. We didn't get to have a party at the end, which sounds ridiculous and that's sad, but that's sort of part of the closure of when you're doing a show. The wrap party is part of this, you know, this is when it ends. So all of that was pretty tough.
I just wanted to know what scene you were both most proud of to shoot.
I think any of the Siege, actually, because we were all together, and you know, I loved the Siege. Probably when we're all in the laundry.
Yeah, that was one of those scenes to shoot where I cried all the way home. They were so confronting.
Yeah, I think because we were all together, and we still had a good laugh as well.
We did.
You know, like you'd say, Carton, you know, be so rageful or whatever, and we'd all burst out laughing after you'd said cut. But I think because we were all together and it was sort of quite dynamic for everyone in that intense laundry scene, it was pretty good. And probably the ones we found the most difficult are the dining room scenes, because it's really hard acting going along the Bay Marie. I know that sounds weird, but acting and walking, and because I was short, there would always be this sort of metal between the eyes.
The stench in the dining room.
And the bad food. And look, if you go back, all you'd see me buttering bread and eating toast. That's all I ate. But yeah, the Bay Marie stuff, strangely enough, when we're all stuck in the actual dining room, there was great scenes in the dining room, but to shoot them, it would take a long time as well, because it was everyone's point of view.
Because there are often a few different storylines going on in the dining room at any one time, right? So there'd be Lou Kelly and doing the thing over here, then there'd be other storylines. So they've got to cover all of these little kind of story threads that are happening in the one space.
I loved the scene with you in the car. I loved shooting that. That was a really emotional I was just always so grateful to get something to do, where I wasn't just running after people in high heels or opening frickin' doors.
I remember that scene. That was a great scene. We'd always do this kind of great thing where, you know, you'd film one of these scenes, it was quite an emotional thing or something, and then they'd say cut, and then you just give each other a big hug and say, you know, it's a pleasure working with you. That kind of thing, like, we go, so great, I just love this job sort of thing, and we'd have a big cuddle after it, and it sort of just released all of the energy that was sort of pent up within that scene. I actually love the siege scene too, because of for different reasons, because I pretty much got a week off. Because Will and Jake are up in the kind of the security room, up in the kind of the executive offices and stuff, and it's all been blocked off by Sean Brody. And that siege took like a whole week to shoot.
And it was
so all that
freezing.
Stuff was down there, and we just had the week off. We just, you know, went on holidays.
Well, some of us had guns to our heads.
Yeah, that's right.
Does that answer your question?
Thank you so much. Yeah, perfect. Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
Which fuck you? There's
a few of them, right?
The one where you yelled it to Kaz when she walked out of your cell.
Oh my god.
I mean, that would be in the moment.
Many, yes, I don't want to hurt anyone's ears, but I think.
Well, you don't want to do your voice of mischief either.
Yeah, I don't know where the anger comes from sometimes. okay, let's give it a go. Fuck yeah!
That's when you die. More than the finale of Wentworth. And
yeah.
I was so taken back at, like, my partner had to console me because I was just distraught, basically. And when I put it on Facebook, initially, 10 minutes after that episode ended, all my friends brought me back down to reality and said, you spoiled it for us. And but I was that distraught because I loved you so much because you redeemed yourself. And I guess my question to both of you is, even though the script came out, did you guys have decide what development your characters would be? Did you choose, did you want to die? Or, like, you know, let's
Yeah, start. Look, I don't think they planned for Mari to die.
Oh.
Do you know, I think they planned for Ali to die, strangely enough. But poor Ali, I think, had been through enough of it. I remember Pino, who's a producer, called me in and said, we've decided to kill Mari. And I stood there and I went, after everything she's been through, you're just going to kill her. And I went home and cried. I felt really upset because, you know, it was the time where Mari had just started to think, I really need people, I love people, and what I've done in the past is just, you know, not the right kind of behavior. And and for everything that she'd been through to kind of go to kill herself and the life she had, to then just be killed in a bin room.
That's Wentworth.
I just felt like I was killed in the garbage room. And I felt really, really upset. And, you know, and then when Will comes in, it's funny because I get upset now about it. When Will.
Sorry.
No, that's all right. It's just that I really got to love Mari. Yep. You know, not that I didn't love her at the beginning, but I really loved her and I just wanted her to be part of a family. I wanted her to be an H1 and be really loved and loved back to life so she didn't have to be so angry.
It was redemption, wasn't it? That whole.
But it's almost like she had to die.
No.
Yeah, I remember. I felt really sad at the end. I really, really did. So, and not because of the actor getting, you know, not being in the last episode. There's a little bit of Jell-O Vanello there that I wasn't in the big explosion at the end.
You're alive.
But the thing is as well, you know, my dog was dying at the time. And I also meant that I could go home a bit earlier because of that. I'm really straight. It's really weird that I actually felt really emotional. But, that's what kind of Wentworth does for all of us and for us actors, you know. in
we love
Benjamin.
You. We love you.
So I couldn't go home, and I always thought I'd get the call to say that my dog, would die. But I ended up going home, and I had 6 weeks with her. So, yeah, she's just the most beautiful little rescue dog, and I loved her a lot.
Mm-hmm. Thanks, Susie. Next.
How does your characters impact you guys in real life?
Well, I get the ass bat now on the kids. I'm very good at that drive home for me was a good shedding off of anything, to be honest. I had about a 45-minute drive home from set, so I would play music and I could shake her off. There were a couple of times, I remember the yard with the where I had a shiv held at my throat for 2 days. That was really hard to shake off, that really upset me. The siege, I couldn't shake off. But the sassy part of Linda is a little bit of sassy Jacquie as well. So, you know, I like a good one-liner. But yeah, I could shake her off. Yeah.
Yeah, I think for me it was a number of things. So, like maybe in season 7, when I became top dog, like I kind of not walk around thinking I was great, but I kind of had this sort of swagger about me. And at times I'd be chatting with my husband at home, and he's like, "Look, I don't think you're top dog here." And I automatically was kind of like had this sort of felt this power. With that, it's so strange. And then obviously in the last sort of 20 eps, it was completely different where she had lost all her power. And I suppose I would look at that where I felt powerless in life in a weird way. So it really kind of touched me a lot, those last seasons, in so many ways, you know. Where someone feels so powerless in their life. And yeah, it was really, really quite difficult. And my family, like, you know, quite a number of suicides. And so that was hard to deal with as well. Not that I would ever talk about that publicly, but yeah. So I think that's quite profound and sad as well when people want to take their life. I think that really affected me.
Both shows. But my question to you, to you both, is how was it working with Pamela Ray?
Wow. I mean, in one word, I reckon. Wow. With Pam. Yeah, like, and do you know what the weird thing is, Pam? You probably, well, you'll obviously, some of you maybe already met her or seen her on stage, is that she is the most beautiful person. Like the most loving, nurturing, but she's got a wicked sense of humour. She's as smart as the freak. But working with her was something that, I did a film with her many, many years ago, and also with Marta Dusseldorp called
Paradise Row.
Oh, thank you, guys. Yeah, that was a long time ago. But Paradise Road, and that's when I first met Pam. And I just think she's an extraordinary actor and an extraordinary person. And look, I know that it's funny because I did an acting class. I took this class with a whole lot of actors yesterday, and we all did Wentworth scenes. And there was a number of them with Ferguson. And I said to these actors, like, this is the gift. Like, this woman is so complex and so interesting and so rich. And I think Pam Ray just steps into the shoes and just kicks it out of the park.
I remember when they said they were bringing her back, I thought, this is never going to work. But it did, because an actor of her, you know, quality, she could make anything work. She's just, she's an amazing person and actor.
Yeah.
I haven't had the pleasure of watching you that much on stage, because you primarily Sydney, and I grew up in Melbourne as a young actor, but
Pamela Ray has done every single play you could possibly even imagine, right? And I have seen her in so much theatre and stuff. So before I even got to Wentworth, I was kind of like, I knew that she was there. And I was kind of like, oh God, you know, just sort of, I was kind of really freaked out by sort of meeting her and stuff. I thought she'd be quite intimidating. I felt like she would be really intimidating, you know, and that's because of the character. And I had met her briefly. I think my brother did a play with her and stuff. But then just meeting her and the warmth and the openness and, you know, I really credit her as much as anybody else in the cast for allowing me to step up to a higher plane of acting skill, I guess. And that's everybody in the cast as well. I mean, not just Pam, but early on in season four, you know, Jake and the freak had this kind of dance going on, you know, at the end of season five and stuff like that. So I had a lot of scenes with her that I felt like she was allowing me to step up to her level of acting, and I definitely became a better actor from the experience.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Yeah, she's just extraordinary. I grew up watching her, and I was so frightened of her. And so, yeah, so to then be in the show was the highlight of my career, yeah.
You know, she could suck my... the best line I've heard in the show, by far.
Well, let's face it, Judy was an interesting character, wasn't she? Judy was...
A cunt.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah. Yeah, and I think that's a great thing when people really, when you're in prison and, you know, you've got maybe that you won't be released for quite a number of years, if ever, you, yeah, would have to learn to have a bit of sense of humour, and nothing really matters and you can't offend someone, you know. So I'm glad you think that, because I never viewed Mari, I mean, obviously I always view Smiles as like the best one-liners ever, but I never viewed Mari as that, but that's nice that you say that.
You were great. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I loved you guys both on the show. You both did amazing jobs. I have a question for each of you. My first one for Susie would be, what do you think, like, I know after Mari sort of had, like, her journey in the isolation and the suicide attempt, like, she changed her feelings towards killing Ruby, but... what do you think was the turnaround to the point where she'd actually risk her life to save Ruby? Like, you know, it's one thing to go, I'm not going to kill her, but to actually go to that level, like, what do you think changed Mari's mind?
I think when there's a scene where her son comes back to her as a sort of apparition, and I think that was a turning point, that her son, like I had in my own head, that my son, who'd obviously died, but was able to say, Mum, I kind of forgive you and love you and keep going. I think that was a big thing. And also the idea of wanting to kind of, yeah, that's a really interesting question. But I think it was that, the suicide, and I think slowly over time, also having the relationship with Reb, like learning to love someone again, and realise that, okay, the best thing in life is to give love rather than to get what you want. And so I think that was sort of a big turning point. But I did love that character arc, that I came in, found that Ruby was there to kill, you know, to kill my son, sort of as an accident, but still killed him. And the simple fact that at the end, Mari saves, you know, gives up her own life for that, I think is a really great story arc. So I think, yeah, just through that slowly over time, I think Mari changed to realise that she really needed people. It wasn't about power or money or status. It was just that you just need people and love in your life.
Yeah, I love the reaction of her. And my question for you, Jacquie, was... do you feel like in, like, the last two seasons of Wentworth, you know, a lot of the Wentworth, you know, showed Linda's gambling addiction and that she liked gambling, but the last two seasons it didn't really touch on her gambling addiction or where she went with that? Do you feel like she just, the PTSD made her change her views on gambling, or do you think she still had an issue, or why they didn't address it?
Yes, I really struggled with that because I wasn't main cast. They were never going to go beyond. They were never going to tap further into it, which was really frustrating as an actor. I think she had to keep her gambling in check. I think she was literally getting through hour by hour, minute by minute. I don't think she was gambling at the end. I don't think she was capable of doing anything except going to work and going home. I think she was living in a car. I think her life was pretty shit at the end, to be honest. Yeah. But once again, I had to kind of make that up.
Thank you so much.
Smiles was just such a really fully formed character for me. I loved her.
Thank you, Susie.
Yeah.
I've got a couple of videos here. And I used to sort of take a few little behind the scenes videos, but we've been talking a little bit about Judy Bryant. I just want to show you one thing. Big hand for our AV guys, by the way, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you. So they've got a little hard drive up there. I'll just show it. There's one. It's under Rudderwise file, and it's called Viv Walking. I think it's called Viv Walking. So you say that Judy Bryant was a cunt. Well, this is Viv just kind of cruising down. She's got the...
Oh. She's a musical theatre girl, you know that?
She's got the piece of steel stuck out of her because this was on the last day, right, you know, so... and then that was also my, like, I think it was my last day and I'd already finished filming. So if we go to Viv Beer, we can see what I did after she finished shooting that scene. There you go. I had to have a beer after after my last day, so I'm opening up on a thing. Now, it's under, I think it's all, We Go Together. Let's have a look at We Go. I'm not sure if you're in this one, Susie or Jacquie. This is a little bit... Yeah, it's just a little bit of the wiggle. We put this video together. What was the occasion for doing it?
I don't know. It was just a family video.
It's under All, and it's called We Go Together. And we just sort of put this little video together. I think Robbie was part of it, wasn't he?
Yeah, Robbie organised it. It was with all the cast and crew, so there'll be some faces. Takes a lot of people to make this show. Writer, producer.
All right, there you go. It's just a nice
really dark humour about it. I wanted to do the Linda Rapp door opens, door shuts, door opens.
All right, thanks guys. Put your hands together and thank these guys.
Alright guys, we're gonna get them ready for their